أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أم حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا فضربنا على آذانهم في الكهف سنين عددا ثم بعثناهم لنعلم أي الحزبين أحصى لما لبثوا أمدا نحن نقص عليك نبأهم بالحق إنهم فتية آمنوا بربهم وزدناهم هدى وربطنا على قلوبهم إذ قاموا فقالوا ربنا رب السماوات والأرض لن ندعو من دونه إلها لقد قلنا إذا شططا هؤلاء قومنا اتخذوا من دونه آلهة لولا يأتون عليهم بسلطان بين فمن أظلم ممن افترى على الله كذبا وإذ اعتزلتموهم وما يعبدون إلا الله فأووا إلى الكهف ينشر لكم ربكم من رحمته ويهيئ لكم من أمركم مرفقا وترى الشمس إذا طلعت تزاور عن كهفهم ذات اليمين وإذا غربت تقرضهم ذات الشمال وهم في فجوة منه ذلك من آيات الله من يهد الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and his entire household and all his companions and all those who have struggled and strove through the generations to learn the deen, preserve it, put it into practice and convey it in a way that today it has come to us. And may Allah use us to be from amongst those who can do the same. Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all and may He bless our offspring, those to come up to the day of Qiyamah. And may He make us from those who can make the correct choices and decisions in life, especially when it comes to marriage and post-marriage, when we have children and the decisions we make with our children and the way we guide our children, for indeed that will play a big role in the future of the Ummah. The way we mold our children, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide them, learning from the sunnah of Ibrahim alayhi salatu was salam, where he constantly made dua for his progeny, although he had not had as many children, and if he did, he had some later on in his life. As we know, he only had children when he was quite old. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant those who do not have offspring, offspring through his mercy. Ameen. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, the youth today have many responsibilities and we are facing challenging times and we are living in an environment that is not very easy to live in terms of
remaining within the pure and straight path. And at the same time, people may mock, laugh, jeer, and make it difficult for us to live as Muslimin. That having been said, we will fall from within one of two categories. Either we preserve the deen, we try our best, we look for it, we look out for the shaitan and the way he tries to affect us, and we try our best to protect ourselves from the devil, or we get sucked into whatever he has planned in terms of the devil. So we need to ask ourselves, where do I belong? Am I from amongst those who is struggling and striving to learn my deen, to purify my belief, to purify whatever I am doing in terms of acts of worship, and to make sure that I have not allowed the devil to seep into my life, neither by making me adopt sin that is manifest and clear, nor by making me adopt sin that sometimes he makes us feel that this is not a sin. And I'll explain that in a few moments. So this is what we need to be worried about primarily. We'd like to speak and dive straight into the topic, what is the responsibility of the youth? When we say youth, a lot of the times people would think we are referring to the adolescent who is perhaps from 13 onwards or 12, 13, the teenage and beyond. But to be honest, I'd like to make it much broader. Every one of us feels young. You know, we could be clocking 40 years old. Back at home, there is one sheikh who always says that a youth is anyone whose age is made up of two digits. I'm sure you heard that before. So for as long as you are between 10 and 99, you are still young. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. That is not an Islamic definition of it, because we know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has warned us of life and has warned us of what we will be doing in life, and he has made mention of an average lifespan. And the Quran makes mention of an ashud. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ وَبَلَغَ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً. The peak of life. When man gets to the peak, which is 40, which means between your 11, 12, up to the age of 40, you would be considered youth. Although we might not delete you from allowing yourself to be included in that term slightly post the age of 40, but what you need to know is, have you changed? Have you adopted what you are supposed to be adopting as a young man? When the hadith of As-Sab'ah, the hadith of the seven categories of people who will be granted the shade of the arsh, or the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that particular day, the special shade that Allah makes mention of in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ تَحْتَ ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. The seven categories of people whom Allah will grant His shade on that particular day. The exact type of shade and how it's going to happen, Allah knows best. But we know there will be a special shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for certain categories of people. One of them is شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. The young man or woman who grew up during that age of youth within the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your concrete is still not molded, it's not dry. Your iron is still hot. What type of a mold do you put into there in order to set it? This is what makes you or breaks you. When you from a young age have protected yourself from bad habits, from getting hooked on to the difficulties of the age, or that which is totally prohibited, should I say, and I've been making mention of it in the last few days because it is indeed a crisis that we face as an ummah. People being hooked on to pornography from the young age of 8 and 9, a'udhu billah, may Allah safeguard us. It damages the mind sometimes irreparably, which means you will not be able to repair it in a rush unless through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It damages the way you look at the opposite sex. It damages so much in terms of the respect you have for yourself and the gift Allah has bestowed upon you, the gender Allah has chosen for you. And it does a lot of damage, and people have accessibility to it at such a young age. And even the non-Muslims are starting to get worried about the difficulties that their own children are facing because of the scourge of the age known as pornography. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, don't even try to discover or to become adventurous. No, the damage of it is severe and it lasts a very, very long time. So youth at that particular age, when you keep yourself within the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why is it that you deserve a special place on the day of Qiyamah? Because during that life, when you have, or that time of your life, when you have the energies, when you think that you are above the world, and you have still gone against your whims and fancies to adopt the desire of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to adopt that which Allah has chosen for you and instructed for you, you definitely deserve a medal. You put yourself after Allah, Allah says, no, you deserve a medal. Meaning, you deserve goodness on the day of judgment. May Allah strengthen us and make us strong.
Amen.
That having been said, we need to know, what is it? That is the duty of the youth. Point number one, we need to protect the responsibility we have, the responsibility we have towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the first point. And let's understand this. The primary point, you have a responsibility to Allah. That is the first thing you are supposed to be looking at. If you have not looked at that, wallahi, you've lost the plot. I started here with a recitation of some of the verses of Surah Al-Kahf with a reason. These youngsters who drove themselves to the cave in order to protect themselves from what? From the disobedience of Allah that was being imposed on them. From the shirk and the association of partnership with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was coming from the top all the way down, and they were unable to save themselves except through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they made a dua to Allah. Oh Allah, protect us. Ya Allah, grant us goodness. Have mercy on us. And Allah says, we kept them secluded for a period, 300 years. 309 years according to the Quran. وَلَبِثُوا فِي كَهْبِهِمْ 300 سِنِينَ وَازْدَادُوا تِسْعًا. We kept them for 300 years and the addition of another 9 years. Some of the scholars of tafsir make mention of the difference between the lunar years and the solar years, that it is exactly 9 years every 300 years. And this is why Allah says 300 years. Some of the older scriptures have made mention of 300. The Quran says an extra 9, because if you are to convert it to lunar, it becomes 309. So this is something that some of the scholars have made mention of. It's quite interesting actually, because it's very accurate. Every 300 years, you get 9 years, subhanAllah, if you convert it from solar to lunar. However, if you get the understanding of that, you will realize that the most important thing that you have as a duty, youngster, the youth of today, myself and yourselves all included, search for the link with Allah, make sure it is valid, make sure it is correct, and you need to know how the devil comes to you to try and take that away. You have a duty unto Allah because He made you. And that duty is, you do not associate partnership with Him in any way. If anything is risky, leave it out. If anything is doubtful, leave it out. The reason is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the Quran very loud and clear, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَٰلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. Allah says, indeed, Allah will not forgive the one who has associated partners with Him. Or He will not forgive the association of partnership with Him, but He may forgive any other sins. This is for a person who has died upon the condition of shirk of any sort and has not engaged in tawbah from that. So if you look at the lives of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the bulk of them were mushrikeen. The bulk of them, before they accepted Islam, were involved in open shirk, that which was of the highest order, worshipping idols and stones. But they accepted Islam. إِنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ يَهْدِمُ مَا قَبْلَهُ أَوْ يَجُبُّ مَا قَبْلَهُ. Islam deletes that which happened before it was actually embraced. The same applies to tawbah. When you engage in tawbah, whatever you've done in the past, if you have sought repentance from it sincerely, with the conditions of tawbah, then indeed you will be from amongst those whose past has been deleted, or the sins you have engaged in the past will be wiped out completely. This is why we say, don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And tawbah is to be sought from Allah directly. You do not seek tawbah from an individual for something you have not wronged them with or about. If I want to tell you, look, I ask you forgiveness, yes, that's if I've done something wrong to you. But if I say I am making tawbah to you in terms of all the sins, the salah I've left and so on, I want you, O Shaykh, to forgive me, wallahi, we've lost the plot. Because the Shaykh is not the one whom we read salah for. And he is not the one whom we obey Allah for. Unlike what sometimes we may hear, may Allah save us from deviation. And we need not get worried. When people talk about shirk, we should be happy that at least they are warning us of something. Today we have a disease where the minute someone says this is shirk or that is shirk, people develop a rash. And they start saying, what's this all about? Wallahi, it is a warning that has come to your ears from the Quran, from the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't get upset. Be happy that at least someone somewhere is warning us. They are telling us. And wallahi, it is a great disease. The first plan of the devil is to make us associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is why we say the first duty that you have as a young man in an environment that is so hostile against not only us, but any form of goodness is to protect your deen, to protect your link with your maker. Because Allah made you, you do not worship anyone but Him. Subhanallah. And you obey the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He created, so He has the right to instruct. أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ To Him belongs what? The creation and the instruction. Because if He created, He has the right to instruct. If He made you, He's got the right to tell you, stand on one foot for 3 hours. I made you, Allahu Akbar. But He didn't say that. He says, look, get up in the morning and do something that will be beneficial for you. This is why we know Salah will benefit us. Does Salah benefit Allah? No, it doesn't. Allah says, we don't need you. Ya أيها الناس أنتم الفقراء إلى الله والله هو الغني الحميد. O people, you are the ones who are in absolute need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as for Him, He is totally independent. So don't think for a moment that your qurba or your act of worship in order to gain closeness to Allah will benefit Allah. No, it will benefit you. So if you are doing it for someone else, do you know what he says? Hadith Qudsi, أَنَا أَغْنَى الشُّرَكَاءِ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا أَشْرَكَ فِيهِ مَعِيَ غَيْرِي تَرَكْتُهُ وَشِرْكَ If you want to associate partners in an act of worship, myself and someone else, you need to know, I am the more independent, or I am the independent of the two partners. I don't need the partnership. It's like you, a multi-millionaire. Say you have a billionaire here in Europe. And then you have a little tuck shop at the side of the corner. You know, one of the corners. Selling, making £20 a day. And this billionaire comes through and you tell him you've got ownership in this 50%. He'll tell you, keep the money. Don't need it. If you want, I give you more. Allahu Akbar. That's a small example of the dunya. Why? He's loaded enough not to need the 20 quid a day. Do you know that? It's nothing for him. He probably makes 20 million a day. Now the example of Allah, لِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى We cannot use this to compare because Allah has a higher example, but we can use it just to draw our attention to something. Allah is the highest. He doesn't need anything. Not my salah, not yours. He says, if you turn away, we replace you with others. Simple. We'll replace you with people in the rural areas of Russia and in the rural areas of South America and perhaps Africa. They've replaced you because you, my sister, decided to abandon your hijab. So what we did is we replaced you with 20 other people in one corner of the globe who perhaps may earn Jannah. Allahu Akbar. And Allah says in the Quran, in more than one place, He warns us. وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ If you are going to turn away, He will do what is known as istibdal, to seek to change. So He will change. He will replace you with someone else. That's what He says. So how many of us want to be replaced? My brother, you don't read your Quran. You don't want to adopt your salah. Allah says, we replace you with other people, someone else. You don't come to the masjid. The masjid is not going to be empty. Others are going to come there. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. My sister, you don't want to read your salah. You don't want to adopt the instruction of clothing and so on. Allah says there are others who will adopt it. So think about this. Your duty as a young person, you need to hold fast upon your deen for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we said Allah created you, so He alone deserves worship. We know إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ You alone we worship, you alone we ask for help. No act of worship whatsoever should ever be rendered for anyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point number two. Why did Allah send the messengers? It's a question. I need to know. If I don't know as a youngster, I will grow up astray. I need to know, why did Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam come? Why was he sent to us? He was sent to us in order to show us how Allah wants to be worshipped. That's it. Subhanallah. So his duty was to show me and you how Allah wants to be worshipped. What is it that is halal? What is it that is haram? And what is it that Allah wants from me and you to do in order to gain closeness to Him, because He made you in the dunya. And making you in this world is in order to test you. We know that. It's a test. So if I want to insult Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than the cartoons and more than the videos and more than those who are swearing him, all I need to do is innovate in the deen. I need to add some act of worship that he did not teach. What that means is, you were sent here in order to show us how to worship Allah, but there's something you forgot. There's something I know that you did not know. Something that man taught me that you didn't teach, which I think I'm achieving a kick from. Wallahi, that's a kick from the devil. It's a fact. So let's warn ourselves. This is why I constantly say, when shaitan grips us, we have a rash. When people talk of shirk and bid'ah, immediately we start saying, what is going on here? Why are they talking about this? These are the most important topics of existence, because your jannah depends. Allahu Akbar. Your jannah depends on whether or not you have engaged in shirk, and whether or not you have understood who Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was and adopted the message as is. We believe, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-islam deena. We read this verse so many times that on this day I have perfected your religion and so on and so on, which means the religion is now complete and the gift for you is now totally complete. Why then do we find ourselves thinking that no, it's not complete, there's still something else that needs to be done? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us recognize our duty as Muslimin to identify that which is insulting to the level of the Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the form of innovation, and to quit it and to leave it no matter what. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. So these are the first two duties that we have as youth. And the reason why we say insulting, I'd like to repeat it again, it's very interesting. If you know why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent, you will realize that he was sent to show me and you how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's already taught us. And he has asked the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, have I conveyed? They said yes. He says, Allahumma fashhad, O Allah, bear witness that they are bearing witness that I have conveyed the message. Subhanallah, today the message came to us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors and grant us goodness.
Ameen.
Then we have duties, more duties, after the duty unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the duty unto the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is part and parcel of the duty unto Allah. We have duties unto ourselves, to take care of yourself, to look after your health, to look after the amanah that Allah has bestowed you with in the form of your body. لِنَفْسِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّى. Give yourself the proper rest at the proper time. Protect yourself from that which is damaging to your health. Remember that if you come across a shisha club, it is haramun haramun haram, no matter what. Remember that. If anyone is telling you makruh, they don't know what they are talking about. The non-Muslims tell you that you are not allowed to sell a pack of cigarettes without writing on it, smoking kills. And we as Muslimin fall into the trap by saying, no ways, they might think it kills, I'm still alive. Allahu Akbar, I'm still alive. And then we say, well, shisha is not that bad. Subhanallah. Last night I was sitting in the city of Bolton, and we had a microphone just like this, which I was holding, and I told him, this looks like one of the shishas that they actually sip, you know. And the worst thing is to find a woman in niqab, through the niqab, using it as a filter, filtering the shisha. Allahu Akbar. Have you ever seen that? Well, I haven't either. It's just an imagination. So, my brothers and sisters, we need to be worried. They say 1 hour of shisha. Go and check it out. 1 hour of shisha is worse than 40 packs of cigarettes. Did you know that? 1 hour of shisha is worse than 40 packs of cigarettes. And we still think that it's not my duty to look after my body. A'udhu billah. Dear youth, it's your duty. You will be asked about the amana that is your body given to you by Allah. You know, to kill yourself in small doses is like a man slicing an organ of a body every day. And 30, 40 days later or a year later, he sliced his whole body. Nobody would do that. Because if you were to take a needle and poke yourself every day in different places, it would hurt. Why then do we not realize it's my duty to give up smoking? I obviously do know that from amongst us there are brothers, perhaps maybe even sisters. Allah safeguard us all, who may have this bad habit, but that must not stop us from telling the truth. And it does not make us dislike you, but dislike your habit. Allahu Akbar. Remember that. We want you to give it up so that you understand your duty unto yourself. As a youth, as a young person, you owe yourself something. What is it? This is a very damaging environment where it is made looked at as something very normal. It's a cool thing to go out and sit and have a little social night out smoking these little bagpipe looking items. And thereafter you have big cigars and everyone wants to puff it out, and they expertise now, they puff it out of their ears somehow. Allahu Akbar, things are happening in winter that we don't even know where this smoke is coming out from. Allah bless us, grant us ease. Your duty to know, don't let the environment suck you in, because that you need to protect your body. Allah will ask you, what did you do? Those of us who are young, who've never ever tried it, don't even go in that direction. Not even a cigarette. Imagine what the ruling would be about drugs. They say weed, Allahu Akbar. They say weed. I'm sure you've heard that the only weed that is acceptable to us is tajweed. Allahu Akbar. My brothers and sisters, it is something very important, you know, to look after your body. Firstly, you're looking after your iman. And then you look after your body, because with a healthy mind, healthy body, inshallah, you will be able to develop closeness to Allah. This is why if you look at the hadith, which is very common in most of the books of hadith, of Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam created the link of that brotherhood known as Mu'akha between him and Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhuma, Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu noticed the wife of Abu Darda was disinterested in her looks or in anything to do with, you know, a female. And he asks, why is this? And she answers in a way. She says, أَخُوكَ أَبُو الدَّرْدَاءِ لَيْسَ لَهُ حَاجَةٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا. This brother of yours, Abu Darda, in this life, he's got no need, basically. Which means I'm just here by the way, woman, Allahu Akbar. Neither is he interested in me nor in anything else regarding the dunya. So, it's a long hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wherein Abu Darda radiallahu anhu gets up in order to pray, and Salman al-Farisi says, no, not now, go and sleep, and so on. The same applies to food, he made him eat and so on. And later on he says, do you know that you have a right? Your body has a right over you, your family has a right over you, your Rabb has a right over you, and everything has a due right. You need to give the right of everything according to its measure. Subhanallah. Abu Darda radiallahu anhu goes to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and narrates the story. The hadith is made up of two words, which means the wording of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, Sadaqa Salman. Subhanallah. He says, Salman has spoken the truth, which means whatever he said, I'm confirming that it's right. So you have a duty unto your body, unto your wife, unto your family, unto your Rabb, and absolutely everyone, subhanallah. These are the duties that you have, my beloved brothers and sisters, so do I. And if you are not going to fulfill your duty on your own body by giving it due rest, by feeding it with that which is halal, by feeding it with that which is correct and beneficial for it, by abstaining yourself from gluttony, by protecting yourself from eating that which is damaging to your health. You know, if for example, you know that chocolates are good, mashallah, for your health. Well, I think they are, inshallah. But more than a certain amount, not good. The same would apply to red meat. Up to a certain amount, alhamdulillah, it will be beneficial. But obviously, if it's halal. But after a certain point, it will be damaging. The doctors might tell you no more. Because you know what? You did not know how to fulfill the right over your body in a lot of cases. In some cases, perhaps due to sickness and illness. May Allah grant cure to all those who are sick and ill in any way. Amen. So it's important for us to realize this. If you were to drive yourself to a nightclub, you are doing an injustice to your own body. Your body does not want to be there. You are imposing upon it to do sin. This is why Allah says in Surah Yasin, اليوم نختم على أفواههم وتكلمنا أيديهم وتشهد أرجلهم بما كانوا يكسبون. On that day we will seal their mouths. Their hands will speak to us. Their legs or feet will speak to us as to what they used to earn. Why? Because these organs of yours are not on your side. They are against you bearing witness or for you bearing witness. May Allah make our organs bear witness for us and not against us. Remember, if your nafs has taken your organs into haram, they will bear witness against you. Unless you engage in sincere repentance, then your organs will be made to forget what happened by the mercy of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. May He open our doors and grant us sincere repentance. It's never too late for as long as you're breathing. But the minute you think, okay, tomorrow, then it's too late already. That thought itself already confirms it's too late. Because Shaitan's first grip is tasweef. Oh, tomorrow I'll do it. You know, I will do it. I will. Don't worry. It's going to happen. When the time comes, I will. No, no, no. That is Shaitan's grip, number one. You need to do it now and constantly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. So that's a duty unto yourself. That's only part of the duties unto yourself. Another duty I can quickly make mention of, my brothers and sisters, never be tempted to tattoo your body. Never. It's a duty you have as a young person and even an older person over yourself, over your body. Do not harm, do not damage, do not engage in that type of behavior. Absolutely unacceptable. Completely. Don't tattoo. I had an email a few days ago from, I think it was a sister, I cannot confirm the gender, but they said, what's wrong in tattooing the name of Allah on my chest close to where the heart is? I said, subhanallah, I wonder which sheikh issued that fatwa. Allahu Akbar. Tattooing the name of Allah close to my heart so that I die with iman. Allahu Akbar. If that was the case, we would have tattooed just like we circumcised our men. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. Wallahi, this type of behavior or to allow ourselves to fall into this type of thinking already shows how hostile the environment is. And this is why it's important for us to remember that the duties we have upon ourselves, there are so many, we are unable to bring them all forth in a short talk of 45 minutes. Subhanallah. But we've just given you a tip of the iceberg. May Allah protect us. You know, a mu'min has been granted a noor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which you can see automatically. It's got nothing to do with your complexion. It's got to do with some shine that Allah's given you, which is recognized by those with a similar shine. إِنَّمَا يَعْرِفُ ذَا الْفَضْلِ مِنَ النَّاسِ ذَوُهُ. It's a common Arabic saying that a person with virtue will only be recognized by a person with a similar virtue. Sometimes someone reads Quran, they absolutely know nothing of tajweed, but their voice is so nice. So some will say, wow, best recitation I've ever heard. And some will say, this man changed the meaning from alim to alim, which means from very knowledgeable to very painful. Allahu Akbar. And you say, but he read very well. It shows one knows, one does not know. It takes one to recognize one. And this is why to know people with iman, you need to have a little bit yourself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us distinguish between right and wrong. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu in tattaqullaha yaj'al lakum furqana. O you who believe, if you are going to be conscious of Allah, He will give you the ability to distinguish. But when you yourself, not conscious of Allah, you want to engage in every sin that is in the book, then you are not going to be able to distinguish between right and wrong. What is wrong will appear right to you, and what is right will appear wrong to you, and that is made mention of as a sign of the hour. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. Then we have duties unto our family, our folk, the families that we are connected to. The Quran makes it very clear of the duties that we have unto our parents. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا. In another verse, إِحْسَانًا. Allahu Akbar. Allah has written upon man goodness to his parents, Muslim or non-Muslim, for as long as they do not instruct you to do that which is in the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you be kind to them, you be good to them, you obey their instruction within that which is within the pleasure of Allah, within the limits of permissibility. Allahu Akbar. Sometimes we cannot even say a good word to our parents. Some of us have no time to sit with our mothers or our elderly grands and to listen to something they have to say perhaps of their childhood, because they become lonely. You see what has happened? A lot of the people that we see around us, and I'd like to think these are غير مسلمين, at a certain age, they flick their parents off into an old age home. Is this the responsibility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed on our shoulders? Is this what we are giving them in return for having brought us up? Allahu Akbar. And the Quran makes it clear, the hadith makes it clear. They looked after you when you were young. رَبِّ رَحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. I will never forget that they brought me up when I was young. So the dua being made, oh Allah, have mercy on them. They are the ones who brought me up when I was little. Subhanallah, may Allah bless our parents. Those who passed away, Allah grant them Jannah. Those who have been brought up by people other than their parents, the reward of those is multiplied, even more. So this is a gift of Allah. Remember your duty unto your family members to guide them, to remind them gently. Sometimes the words we use to remind people to turn to Allah are so harsh that they actually turn further away from Allah. Be careful. There is hikmah required. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always used tact, and he made sure the message was delivered with clarity, but in a good way, subhanallah, in a good way, so that people would feel like coming towards it. And then if someone did not, that was up to them. We tried our best and we put it forth correctly. This should start with our family members, as the Quran says, the duty unto all of us. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nara. O you who believe, save yourselves and your family members from the fire. This is the starting point. So let's understand this as a duty upon us, not only as the youth, but even those who are a little bit older. Wallahi, we have a duty unto our families and so on. Then we have a duty unto our communities, unto the Muslim Ummah. We have duties. We need to make sure we stand together, and we need to make sure that we try to help one another, lest we are downtrodden. Listen to one powerful verse of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of this at the end of Surah Al-Anfal. He says, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوهُ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ كَبِيرٌ. The kuffar are protectors of one another, no matter what they are. الْكُفْرُ مِلَّهُ. The kuffar are protectors of one another. They will protect one another. If you are not going to learn to do the same, or if you are not going to do the same, which means if you are not going to be protectors of one another, there will be great chaos and corruption on earth. Today, if you look at disasters all over, a lot of the times it's because in one masjid, we're divided into 10 groups. Every masjid across the globe, it's not a problem just here. It happens all over. For what? Because of the opening of a window, the working of a fan, the time of salah, the type of a mushaf we have, for example, an Urdu script or an Arabic script. We might have, for example, a clock and so on. People are fighting for the smallest of items. Is that not a plot of shaitan? And are we not the ones who are forwarding it? Can we not look at something common? Can we not come forth with the idea of discussing perhaps point of differences? Yes, if you have a point of difference valid, you may discuss it. You may have a debate perhaps within knowledgeable terms. And at the same time, we may want to discuss it not with the idea of creating hatred, but putting across a point. Perhaps I may learn, you may learn, we all may learn. Someone may correct themselves, but we have a problem. Today, nobody wants to be told anything. That's a problem. Everyone is a professor. And everyone is really a lecturer themselves in their own right. You ask them, brother, what happened? This, I have a heart disease. He says, ask the doctor. If you say, I have a problem at home with the water, they say, call the plumber. Beyond a certain point, call the plumber. I have a problem with this, call that man. I have a problem with my accounts, call the accountant, and so on. But when it comes to deen, I'll give you a big lecture. Don't worry. You don't need to go and find out anything. I know what's going on. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. May Allah safeguard us. Yes, we are supposed to be knowing enough about the deen to safeguard ourselves from that which is the plot of the devil, the initial plot of the devil. The details sometimes we may not know, we need to make an effort to learn. That is also a duty of the youth. Make an effort. What are you doing to learn your religion? Get it from the one whom you trust. Learn your deen from the one whom you trust. And make sure that you always ask yourself, am I involved in that which I'm not supposed to be involved in? First aim of the devil, shirkiyat. Second aim of the devil, bidah. We've already spoke about that. And why it is so important to constantly ask yourself. Every time the devil uses the same plot and plan with all the people and he is succeeding, when it comes to us, we don't want him to succeed. Take a look at how the people of the book went astray. How did they go astray? They raised their messenger into the level of godhood. If shaitan does the same with us, we would fall into the same trap. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson from that. It's very important to look into it. How did shaitan lead the others astray? By making them raise human beings to levels of godhood. Allahu Akbar. We believe Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, afdalul khalqi wa akramul rusuli. He is the highest of creation, the most honored of all prophets. We believe we will adopt whatever he has uttered and said. We believe we will learn a lesson from his blinking and from the nodding of his head. We will learn lessons. But we still believe we do not render a single act of worship to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The minute someone raises him to the level of godhood, we are wrong. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us and grant us the intercession of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of Qiyamah. So these are some of the duties that we have as youth, because this is how the devil comes to us. And he makes us really feel, you know what? What you're doing is not wrong. It's actually right. It's something very, very good. You know, we had a problem with rain. One of the areas, let me not say the exact city. We had a problem with rain in one of the African countries. And the people started praying. So you have some people praying under a tree belonging to a different sect of Christianity. And other people were praying in their churches, some in their synagogues. Muslimin were praying in the masajid. And then we had istisqa, which is the sunnah method of asking for rain and so on. And then you have people saying, Muslimin were saying, you know, the day that those people were praying, we had rain. And the day we prayed, there was no rain. So why don't we also join... I don't even want to end the sentence. That is from the devil. That is from shaitan. And now the person thinks, but what's wrong? Come on, we're human beings. We're asking for rain for everybody, not just for us. So why don't we just have united force of everyone coming together and we can all pray together for rain. A'udhu billah. You are praying to Allah, they are praying to shaitan, and you are standing in one saf, and they are asking the devil for rain, and you are asking Allah for rain. The two do not get together. And if the rain came the day they asked, it's a test for you, but perhaps it is in response of the dua that you made. How do you know? Because we learn that the dua you make may be held back to a certain time as a test for you or a gift for you. And you may get it as you want. Allahu Akbar. So let's never ever fall into the trap of the devil such that we're doing something and we think, yo, this is right, this is the best thing, this is good. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not teach it, believe me, do not insult him by trying to think that this is a good act of worship. It cannot be. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And we have many other duties. We need to be building society and community. The youth need to be worried about those to come. The future generations, your thinking must be 20 years ahead, not just today. And this is why we say those who are killing themselves in the nightclubs and those who are destroying their lives by engaging in illicit affairs with the opposite sex and wasting their lives on WhatsApp and on BBM and Facebook and Twitter. Every 2-3 minutes we're refreshing, we're looking at our phones, we're messaging and so on. Wallahi, you may use social networking either to destroy you or to benefit you. I'd like to think 80% of people do not use it as beneficially as they should be. That's what I think. And this is why we do not encourage the use of social networking unless you are disciplined. If you are very disciplined and you know what you're doing, then you may use it. If not, wallahi, it has been the means of the destruction of so many marriages. It's a fact of life. You know, one might say, look who's talking. You know that? Why? They might say, you've got a very heavy presence. Go and see how we use it. You will figure out it's very disciplined. Subhanallah. Extremely disciplined. No wasting of time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is why we say, don't be confused. Sometimes we are forced to do certain things in order to show a few words of guidance to the masses, because that's perhaps one of the few methods that really go down well with them. That's all. This is thinking future. I know a few years ago, when this whole thing happened, and I used to put up a message on Facebook once a day, and I had a lot of ulama, my friends, my own friends, come to me and say, "Ya Sheikh, this is haram. You know what you're doing? Totally." I said, I also used to give lectures, if you go back and search, that this was haram. But now I've seen a different light. The youth are on it. And they don't come to the masjid, they don't come to the lectures in a rush. And they need some form of guidance. They're not getting it. They're hooked. Look, look, let's see. Open up the profiles and look at the likes. What do our people like? Wallahi, they love all these people who are gagged and so on across the globe. May Allah protect us. This is what's going on. And you see them, Muslimin, muhajjabat, a woman completely covered. But on Facebook you see likes, and she's got 20 different movies that she's ticked on. Why? There is no option of Islam on that whole network. A few years ago, very little. So anyway, I took a lot of flack. People call you names, they label you, but I had my own father, alhamdulillah, Allah grant him goodness. Ameen. He told me, look, you know what? If you know what you're doing, put your head down and do not worry about what's being said. Carry on doing the work. One day they will see the light behind it. Today, every one of those friends of mine has a profile. Allahu Akbar. Every one of them, without exception. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. And they're using it in good, not in bad. Very disciplined, open, transparent. The account is not closed either. The sisters, nothing wrong in blocking your account except for those whom you allow. Because remember, like I said 2 days ago, I think it was in Preston, where it was a beautiful statement that just came out of my mouth. I said, not everyone who says hi to you should be responded, because half of them want to make you hi. Allahu Akbar. So they say hi, and then you say hi, that's the beginning of a match. Choop. That's what it is. It's a match. You know, matchstick. Mind you, it could be a different type of a match either. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. Wallahi, you can be destroyed, my beloved youth. Completely destroyed through your mobile phone. Your marriage breaks. Everything happens. If you're not married, you have such a reputation that people know, you know, this person here is thrown from left to right and is free for all. What type of a marriage will you have? What have you built? Have you thought of your grandchildren? Allahu Akbar. You know, when youngsters come and they say, I want to get married to this particular girl, mashallah, you know, if she's a Muslimah, and sometimes, like I said yesterday, again, in one of my talks, if a young boy comes to you and wants to marry a female, first you've got to say, alhamdulillah. It's a female boy. That's the age we're living in. Wallahi, it's the age we're living in. If your son comes to you and wants to marry someone's daughter, firstly, thank Allah. It's someone's daughter, not someone's son. Secondly, if that person is ready to accept the deen of Islam, thank Allah again. Thirdly, if that person is close to a type of a dream you might have had for your own child, thank Allah even more. Because ideally, we move from this direction. We have a dream for our children. We'd love to see them marry within whatever we would feel they would be successful with. But if they don't do that, we might be forced to be pushed to the next step, which we may not be absolutely excited about, but we might have to accept it because of the environment we're living in. And third step is the last step. Beyond that, there is no step. So this is why we say, when a youngster, in fact, the one particular case, young man came to me, and it was something quite absurd. He wanted to marry someone really who did not have a reputation, not even a Muslim to start with, but not even a good reputation, for whatever reason. And I said, brother, can I ask you a question? Have you ever sat and thought of your grandchildren? He says, what? Are you okay? I said, what do you mean? I'm asking you a question. Have you sat and thought of the grandchildren of yours? What type of grandchildren would you like to have? He says, I've never thought of even my own children, because I haven't got there. You know, nowadays we believe live every day as it passes. Subhanallah. Yes, you live every day as it passes under certain issues. But the dream of life, the planning of the future, you need to have a dream for the future. Ibrahim alayhi salam made dua for his generations. He says, oh Allah, from my generations, let there always be people who will be surrendering to you. مسلمين لك. The two of us. ومن ذريتنا أمة مسلمة لك. Oh Allah, from my progeny, from the generations to come whom I may not see, keep from amongst them those who are submitters unto you. Subhanallah. So I said, think of your grandchildren. What type of grandchildren will you have? And he says, I didn't think. I said, well, the type of spouse you choose will determine the type of children you have. And the type of children you have will determine, mostly, obviously you can have exceptions, definitely by the mercy of Allah. But mostly it would determine the type of grandchildren you have as well. Because you've taught them how to select. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is why we say, don't make mistakes. At an early age, when you make a blunder, what happens? Wallahi, you lose focus. I need to make mention. Some of you might have heard this. I made mention of it at a college that I visited. I think it was in Blackburn a few days ago. And I want to say it again because it is something that teaches us a lesson. Think of the example of a man who is a porter, who is at a train station carrying bags of people from point A to point B, getting 50 pence a throw. And suddenly, a rich man comes, walks out of the train with a can of milk. And he says, young man, I will give you 10 pounds if you carry this can of milk from here to my place, which is about a mile down. And this man is excited. Wow, 10 whole pounds. That's like 20 trips that I've been making at 50p each. I'm going to get it one throw. He says, no problem, sir. I am experienced. I will not drop your milk. And you know, they put the milk on top of their heads and they balance it. These porters are experts. They actually can run with it. Don't try it, but they can do it. They will put it on their heads and run with it. This man puts it on his head and he starts walking and he's smiling from ear hole to ear hole. Allahu Akbar. And he says, oh, I'm going to get 10 pounds just now. And I will go straight to buy two chickens. And these chickens will lay eggs and I will sell the eggs. And when I sell a few eggs, I'll buy a third and fourth and fifth chicken. Then I'll have a fowl run. I'll employ 10 guys to run that place. Then I will buy more chickens and I will sell eggs and chickens. And I will slaughter chickens and open a little abattoir. And I will be able to get those chickens across to the butchers. Then he says, after that, I'm going to buy sheep. And then I'll buy a little farm. And on that farm, we'll have so many sheep. And I'll sell a little sheep as well as slaughtering them and providing the butchers with halal mutton. Then he says, thereafter I'll buy cows. But look at him, 10 pounds. He's talking, just 10 pounds. But this is forward thinking, beautiful thinking. It's really good. He's got a plan. Wallahi, he's got a good dream. He's not planning haram. He's planning something good for his future. Then he says, and after that I will move further. And I will have a whole farm and I'll go into crop and I will be able to harvest and I'll be able to sell. And then I'll buy the big buildings in the city, that one and that one and that one and that. And by the time I'm the biggest businessman around, the girl I went to propose for last year, because her father's the mayor, they said no to me. They will get to know about me themselves. And when they get to know about me, the father will come and say, will you please marry my daughter? And when he comes, I'll be so upset, I'll tell him, no! So when he shook his head, the can of milk dropped. When the can of milk dropped, the owner of the milk turns around and says, hey, didn't I tell you I would pay you 10 pounds for this milk and not to drop it? He says, hey, relax, relax. You know, that's my favorite word, relax, take it easy. You just lost a can of milk. I lost my chickens and my eggs and my sheep and my cows and my farms and my buildings. And 600 people lost their jobs. And at the same time, I lost my marriage and my whole life is gone. So just keep quiet, okay? What's the moral of that? The moral of it is, one small distraction in your life can shatter your dreams, my brothers, my sisters. One teenage pregnancy, it's over. Your life will have to be reshaped. You start all over again from the beginning. We've spoken to sisters who've fallen. May Allah safeguard all of us, our daughters and our sisters. Remember, you've made a mistake. Carry on in life with tawbah. Allah will wipe it out. We don't look down upon people who've engaged in tawbah, never. But we might learn a lesson from something people have been through. So this is why we say, If you ask them what happened, they'll say, Wallahi, I lost focus for just 10 minutes. For how long? Few minutes. Lost focus. What happened? 9 times out of 10, they'll tell you the guy responsible for the pregnancy has disappeared. He's not interested. He's upset. He wants me to abort. He wants this. He wants that. So what did you do? You fell prey to, I love you. That's all. Anyone can say it. They put a big tashdeed on the L, 3-4 tashdeeds, and the woman melts. Allahu Akbar. It's just a tashdeed that is required to melt a woman. Is that the case? You're too gullible, my sister. Don't do that. Allahu Akbar. Wallahi, it's a fact. See, the youngsters are laughing because they know it works. Allahu Akbar, please don't try that. Not at all. We shouldn't be doing that. So my brothers and sisters, this is your responsibility to watch out. Look at the environment. Make sure you are not distracted. We are heading for Jannah. MashaAllah. Yes, we are. Alhamdulillah. We are heading for Jannah, my brothers and sisters. We are trying to get there. That is our aim. If you lose focus for a minute, your can will drop. Believe me. Then you will lose. Allah doesn't lose. You lose. Your can is gone. Your dreams are shattered. What more do you want? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an opening. And really, may He open our doors. My brothers and sisters, we've spoken quite a bit. And we've said a few of these distractions. And our duties as youth to understand the distractions, to safeguard ourselves from this, to know your link with Allah, to build it, to understand your link with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to build it. He is the messenger, he needs to be followed. Subhanallah. To understand your link with your community, to be an asset to society, to know how to deal with difference of opinion, to understand this man is closer to me than the others. And I need to know if I am standing together with him, the others will not be able to tread upon us as a united front. The minute we are all in little small groups of 10, 20 in one masjid, someone can come and mow the lawn over us. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beautify our own garden. And may He make us from those who recognize. May He bless us in this world and the next. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك